First batch of 4 million extra Pfizer doses from London have touched down in Sydney, the precious cargo secured as part of a major vaccine swap with the UK.
Lieutenant General John Frewen heads the COVID vaccination task force and he joins us now live from Canberra. Nice to see you this morning. Where exactly will these jabs be going?
Good to see you guys. Yes, these jabs will be distributed all around the country on a per capita basis like we've done before, Ali. So I know every state and territory are looking forward to getting their hands on them.
Almost 38% of Australia is fully vaccinated now. When do you expect the nation to hit those 70 or 80% marks?
Yeah, look, we've got a fantastic opportunity to get to 70. We've got a really strong opportunity to get to 80 this year. I'm not tying to dates myself, but I think, you know, come November, if we're not up into the 70s, then we've probably missed an opportunity. So it really is now about people turning up to get vaccinated. So I just encourage everybody to, if you haven't booked, get booked. And if you've had your first dose, get along for your second dose.
Your issue you've got, as you would know, some states are charging, typically those who've had to deal with COVID outbreaks. Are you worried about hesitancy, especially in Queensland right now?
Yeah, look, Ali, I've got one eye firmly fixed on hesitancy issues. Again, I say we've got the supply, we've got the distribution networks now. We've now got more than about 9,400 places people can go to get vaccinated. We intend over the next couple of weeks to make that more than 10,000. So really, it all just does come down now to people turning up. The public sentiment is really strong around vaccinations. People are saying that they have every intention of getting vaccinated, but just watching overseas experience and watching some of the communities where we're starting to lag behind, hesitancy is a key factor. So we've just got to make sure that the right information is out there and people understand just how important it is to be vaccinated.
It's not an easy job what you're doing. Effectively what you end up with is a patchwork quilt of different variables and different levels of vaccine in even one city. I mean, that's the hard thing to confront.
Yeah, well, look, we're watching that really carefully. The government have set these targets of 70 and 80% both across the nation and across the jurisdictions, but I'm really mindful of we've got to try and bring everybody along equally. So we're doing a lot of work at the moment to make sure Indigenous communities are brought along. Also very conscious that there are, you know, pockets of disadvantaged people as well that, you know, we just need to make sure they've got access and they've got the right information.
Lieutenant General, is there anywhere in Australia where supply is currently an issue?
Now, look, now with these 4 million doses of Pfizer coming, this is really the sort of rates of supply we were expecting in October. We've also got Moderna turning up in the next couple of weeks too, Ali, which is great. That's another mRNA vaccine that we'll be running out through the pharmacy network. So really the supply isn't the big challenge from here on in. Of course, there are some places where there are really particular challenges, you know, very, very remote areas, but we've got supply chains in place that can get those vaccines out to those areas as well.
There are some amongst us who are really early with some of these vaccinations and really early with the double dose. And now, especially with Pfizer, they'll be coming to the end of their efficacy and they'll need a booster shot. Do we have the supply to handle that?
Yeah, so look, the Department of Health is still another agencies such as ATAGI are still finalising their views on exactly when booster shots will be required. But we've got adequate, Pfizer in particular, this year. There's already been orders placed for both next year and the year after for a booster program. So once the outlines are in place of exactly what the timeframes will be, there'll absolutely be the supply, and we're already putting plans in place to make sure we have a smooth transition from the vaccine rollout writ large into what we call a business-as-usual type booster program in future, like you see with flu shots.
Let's talk about kids, because I know the TGA has approved Moderna for 12 to 17-year-olds. Is there going to be a preference for children, whether it's Moderna or Pfizer?
No, Ali, they're very, very comparable vaccines. What we're doing logistically is we're going to run the Moderna out through the pharmacies, just because they've only had access to AstraZeneca for now. Pfizer will continue to go out through the GP networks and the other state and territory hubs. So really it's a brand, it's a bit like flu shot. People don't know that there are, you know, six or seven different flu shots every year. They just go and get their flu shot. So Moderna, Pfizer, it's really which is the best place, most convenient place for you to go, and with the kids, for parents to take their kids with, you know, consent to get vaccinated.
Look, just one final one on hesitancy. I mean, there are still a number of healthcare workers who are not getting it either via supply or they just don't want it. How are we going to address that? And do you think that if you haven't convinced people right now to get vaccinated, how are you going to do it in the future?
Yeah, so we'll continue our ad campaigns, our information campaigns. As we're getting further into the rollout now, it will become clearer where the really strong pockets of hesitancy are. And where we find those, then we'll tailor right. information campaigns and advertising campaigns very specifically for those. What I find, if it's a particular community or a particular area, it really comes down to engaging local leaders and getting those local messages with the best information to the people, from the people who they trust.
We will reach 80% though, will we? Won't we?
Carl, we've got every opportunity to get there. It really is about Australians, people in Australia, making that decision to step forward. So supplies here, distribution networks here. It's really about getting out there for you, for your family, for your friends. You know, this is a national imperative. This is a major health crisis. We've seen through the outbreaks in Victoria, New South Wales, Western New South Wales, just how dangerous this virus is. Vaccination is the way to keep us all safe.
Lieutenant General, always a pleasure. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, Father's Day is usually celebrated around a dining table or cooking or kicking a footy in the backyard with loved ones. But for many families on the Queensland-New South Wales border, it was marked with a quick hug and kiss over an orange barricade. For more, we're joined by the Mayor of the Tweed Shire, Chris Cherry. Nice to see you, Chris. It's hard for so many. What did you make of those scenes yesterday?
Oh, look, it was heartbreaking, I think, to see, you know, what we saw, I think, was the tip of the iceberg of the thousands of people, families that this is affecting. And just seeing all of those people that have had to make the choice between keeping their business open and not seeing their family, or keeping their job that's in Queensland and not being able to come home to dinner at night, and just taking a moment to just reconnect. And it's really heartbreaking.
Carl and I have been speaking this morning. We got quite teary watching these images. And just hearing some of the stories, you know, of families being separated for more than a month because, as you said, someone works on one side of the border and the family's on the other. Was it nice to see that police weren't stopping people from hugging and kissing and having that connection?
I think the police did an incredible job here yesterday, just the amount of compassion that they showed and just that real understanding. And to know, you know, I mean, the closest case of COVID that we've got is 2.5 hours south. We haven't had a case of COVID here for more than 12 months. So, you know, they showed a lot of compassion.
Yeah, I thought it was very beautifully handled by the police yesterday. I know that some of these families, they live just minutes away from each other. And it's moments like this, isn't it, that make the border restrictions seem, I think, unfair.
Yeah, I think we've seen an incredible amount about the impact, the economic impact, but just looking at this human impact on people's mental health, on their well-being, it's really, really high, and that's why we're just calling on both governments to please reconsider moving that checkpoint south. Please, you know, look at lifting our lockdowns and let us get our communities back together.
This is the drama though, Chris, isn't it? As you know all too well, our state leaders, they are far from reaching a resolution on this. Do you hold out any hope?
Look, I think you always have to have hope. I think, you know, nobody with a heart could look at what happened yesterday and not think that something has to be done and urgently, because, you know, these are our families' lives that are being affected like this. And I know people are suffering all over the state, and I don't want to take anything away from that. People are hurting everywhere. But, you know, this is in an area that hasn't had COVID for more than 12 months.
So what would you be proposing to our state leaders? What do you see as a workable solution?
So the MPs all along the Northern Rivers region here, and joined by the Gold Coast MPs, are still calling for those border checkpoints, so the COVID checkpoints, to be moved further south. So whether that's the Tweed Shire or the whole Northern Rivers, So that's, you know, that's our main aim. Obviously, I joined with the other Northern Rivers mayors on Friday to have a joint call out for New South Wales government to release us from the regional lockdowns because of the lack of COVID cases that we have. So, you know, there's a lot of things. And we're also asking if they could tighten up those exemptions that come up from Sydney, because, you know, that's the last thing that we need at the moment.
All right. Chris, thanks for joining us this morning. We appreciate it.